Welcome back to Gemology for Schmucks, everybody. My name is Peter Nelson, and today we're going to be talking about one of the concepts with gemstones that you can test both with your eyes and with scientific tools. This concept is one of the main things that the ancients were relying on to distinguish different types of gemstone. Even with your naked eye, sometimes you can perceive this characteristic of the gemstone. What it is called surface luster. And surface luster is basically how much light is reflecting off of the surface of the stone as opposed to piercing and going in. Why does light reflect off of the surface as opposed to refract, pierce, and go in? All materials have a certain angle that is required in order for light to pierce and go in. You can kind of think of it as a cone. So if light is coming within that cone, within that range, that critical angle, then it will be able to pierce and get into the stone. If it's coming from too wide of an angle, if the cone is like this and the light comes from this angle, for example, it's not sharp enough to pierce the stone. So what it does is it hits the surface and then it bounces off. So that critical angle is connected to something called the refractive index. And what that is the difference of the speed of light in air and the speed of light in the gemstone. You can kind of think of it like optical density. It's how much does light slow down in the stone. So if the difference in between those two speeds is higher, then it's going to reflect more light. And so if you have something like a diamond that has a very high RI, or refractive index, that means that the angle that light needs to hit the stone at in order to pierce in is very tight. It's very narrow. So light that doesn't come from the right angle, if it's coming from too shallow an angle, it just hits and bounces off the surface. And that's why the surface reflection on a diamond is so white and so crisp and so sharp. Anything else with a high refractive index like that, maybe things like spinel, things like corundum or sapphires or rubies, when light hits the surface and bounces off, you see a very bright shine on the surface. Garnets as well. Anything with a lower refractive index, what's going to happen is when light hits it, that cone, that critical angle, is wider. And so when light hits the stone, it's more likely to pierce and go in. With colored gemstones, that's a great thing, because more light going in means there's more likelihood that light's coming out and showing itself to us as full color. Emeralds, for example, have a very low refractive index, and so you see a lot of sumptuous color. A lot of light can get into the stone, but you sacrifice that surface luster. Refractive index is absolutely 100% connected to the mineral itself, the chemical composition, and the crystal structure. So when we're trying to identify what is this mineral, what is that mineral, we rely on the refractive index that we can test with this refractometer right here. And this gives us a number. And this number is one of the most important, if not the most important, piece of information that a gemologist uses to distinguish minerals from each other. If we're looking at gemstones, what can we see that will tell us that this has a high refractive index or a low refractive index? Obviously, the ancients wouldn't be using these technical terms. So what were they noticing? Well, when you hold a stone and you're in an environment like this that has strong LED lights, you're not going to notice a whole lot. But if you're in a diffused lighting situation, like maybe the shade of a tree, you're still getting a lot of light from the environment, but not necessarily directly from the sun. And what you'll notice is on the surface of the stone, in the facets, you'll see that some areas maybe are a little bit more gray with the reflection, and that's going to be a low RI stone. If it's got a high reflection, then that's a higher RI, higher refractive index. And so why is this important? Well, if you've got a given stone, for example, emerald or anything in the beryl family, then you know that it's going to be a low RI. That surface reflection is going to be lower. So if you find a green stone, you hold it in your hand, and you see that the reflection off the surface is quite bright, then you know that, no, this isn't going to be an emerald. This is going to be something else. Even if they're the same color of green, it's likely that you can distinguish the two apart based on their surface luster alone. So let's look at some stones. Here in front of me, we've got two stones. One of them is amethyst, one of them is corundum. It's a purple sapphire. If I tell you that corundum has a higher refractive index and quartz has a lower refractive index, amethyst is quartz, can you tell me which stone is which? Look at the facets, look at the reflections, and decide which one you think is amethyst, which is sapphire. Now, if you look at this next picture, I've highlighted the areas that have reflections that you can focus on, and try and decide which one you think is a brighter luster, a brighter reflection. Here it is, close up again, without the boxes. Which one do you think is brighter? Which one do you think is dimmer reflection? Try and get in your mind which stone you think has the higher luster and which one has the lower luster. Now, I know that some of you are going to say, oh, I can distinguish these two stones based on color alone. And you might be able to in this situation. But in many situations, the colors can overlap completely. Color will deceive you. Do not trust it. Luster, however, will never deceive you, and if you can learn to recognize and distinguish different levels of luster, you'll go a long way to stop being a schmuck and being a professional. Right here, we've got four green stones. Now, I understand that the colors are different, but focus once again on those reflected facets. Which one do you think has higher? Which do you think has lower refractive index? Here, we've got the highlighted areas that I'd like you to focus on to judge their luster off of. And right here, we've got each of the stones doubled, one with the boxes, one without. Which do you think is higher? Which do you think is lower? I understand that I was kind of cheating, and I did organize them based on their refractive index. The one with the lowest luster is emerald on the far left, going up through tourmaline, which is a higher luster, savorite, which is a type of garnet, and then zircon, which has the highest luster by far. Now, if you focus just on those facets, the emerald on the far left has a much more muted, much more gray reflection off of its facets. And that's not just because of the source of the light in this photo. These stones are all right next to each other. The amount of light they're going to get is very comparable. And you can see that the table of the stone is all oriented towards the camera. In this next photo, we've got a wide array of lusters, wide array of refractive indices. In the top left-hand corner, we've actually got an opal, and hopefully you can see that its facets are quite gray, very comparable with the emerald. If you go to the top right-hand corner, you can see sphalerite. Sphalerite is a mineral with a very high refractive index. You can see that on the sphalerite, the two facets that are at the bottom part of the table are actually really bright, really white. That's because sphalerite has a very high refractive index, higher even than zircon. It's comparable with diamonds. The metallic looking stone in the bottom part of the photo is a black diamond. I know it looks like hematite. I promise you it's not. I tested. So the sphalerite and the black diamond have a very similar refractive index, and both of these are unreadable on the refractometer because it's just too high. The nice thing about this characteristic of gemstones is that it doesn't matter if the stone has color or not. You can notice the surface luster of a stone regardless of what its color is. So if you're looking at green stones, it can help you distinguish between different types of green stones, even if their color is the same. So for example, we were just looking at emerald and savorite and zircon and tourmaline, right? Those colors can match up completely. I know my example stones didn't match up completely, but for example, savorite, which is Grosseleer garnet, savorite and emerald can have the exact same colors. And in emeralds, it doesn't split light so far, so you're not going to see doubling. It's not going to help distinguish between garnet in that way. So we have to rely on something else. And one thing that you can notice just with your naked eye is that surface luster. Grosseleer garnet has a much higher RI, and so it's got a much higher luster. Beryl and emerald have a much lower RI, so they have a much weaker luster. In a buying scenario, how can this help you? Well, it can help you to broaden your horizons on what stones you're actually interested in. Some stones may have a weak color, but maybe you just want something that's got a lot of flash. So gemstones like spinel, for example, have a very high refractive index. And so even if the stone is almost black, as you move your hand around, if you're wearing a ring, then you're going to get a lot of sparkle off of the surface. I've got a stone that's just like that. If I'm indoor with that ring, some people are like, oh, that stone looks pretty much black. If I'm outside, you can start to see the color. But regardless of the lighting conditions, you still see a lot of that bright, sharp, crisp reflection. Whereas, for example, if you wanted something that's a little bit more gothic, a little bit dark, if you're wearing something like jet or obsidian, because you want that dark, that black, that moody color, then you're not going to get the same surface reflection. So that's another design element that we as jewelers get to play with. All right, everybody, if you really want to understand luster and if you want to practice it, you need to look at a lot of stones, and you need to look at them in the same lighting conditions. If you take a torch or a flashlight up and you're just looking at stones like this, then everything's going to look like it's got high luster. But if you have diffused lighting, so that's maybe a shaded area or in between two alleys if you're feeling a little sketchy, that way the sun isn't shining directly on you, but you still have a lot of light. It's just like if you talk to photographers, they talk about that being a better area to shoot because you don't have that high contrast glare. If you have any other questions, please give me a comment below and I'll do my best to answer your questions. But realistically, this is going to take some practice. You're going to need to see more stones. You're going to need to look at them side by side. Comparison stones are very important. So if you're looking at something like zircon alongside of beryl, that's going to make it much more obvious for your eye. And once you see it once, you start to see it the second, the third, the 50th time. Once again, I hope that this concept has enhanced your buying experience and your confidence in gemstones, and perhaps most importantly, your appreciation for the natural world. So I hope you have a great rest of your week, and I'll see you next time.